Good morning from the East Coast, and thank you very much for that very nice introduction. I'm going to move right on to my presentation. So I want to talk a little bit about ATCC for those of you who may not be quite as familiar with us. We are primarily known as a not-for-profit biorepository, one of the largest in the world. ATCC has an extensive collection of cell biology products, tens of thousands of individual items, roughly 2,500 are human cell lines. We are typically associated with traditional continuous cancer cell lines, but we also offer a large collection of primary cells, immortalized cells, stem cells, including iPSC, differentiated iPSCs, and other advanced in vitro models. We utilize also our internal R&D capabilities really to leverage our collection and the various technologies to help support the research community. We continue to do so, including via external collaborations and partnerships. And I'm going to be talking about one such project today, our involvement with the Human Cancer Models Initiative. A brief outline. So I'm going to start with some background on the HCMI, briefly go over the goals of the program, which, you know, at a high level is to generate 1,000 novel human patient-derived cancer models. The initiative is utilizing a variety of advanced cell culture technologies. I'm going to focus just on one that they're using, and that's going to be human primary tissue-derived 3D organoids. I'm going to provide a brief overview of the current state of the model portfolio. So what's available now, what's available in the near future from a disease and tissue perspective. And then I'm going to close just describing some of the resources that are available for learning about ATCC and the HCMI collection of models. So to take a step back, you know, why was the HCMI formed in the first place? I think it's sort of well understood that the cancer research community continues to be faced with an ongoing problem that patients don't really respond to treatments as predicted based on preclinical models. And this is despite really a massive effort and advances in things like bioinformatics and sequencing to understand and interrogate primary tumors, as well as the discovery, you know, of many new druggable targets. But this is not necessarily translating actually into new therapeutics. So there's recognition that we need better preclinical models that are more predictive. Of course, there are many types of preclinical models. For the purpose of this comparison, I'm just focusing on cell lines. But, you know, why are the existing cell lines insufficient? There are, of course, many cell lines available, including at ATCC. But in fact, we're lacking large numbers of cell lines for many specific tissues. So, for example, pancreas, liver, you know, are really underrepresented. There's also increasing realization that, you know, some lines have been misidentified or otherwise have been in culture for so long that there's no telling how long it compares to the original tumor. Cancer is, of course, a highly heterogeneous disease, and it involves many known key mutations, but they're not necessarily found in the existing cell lines, or they're not found in the typical combination of mutations that you actually see in real patient populations. Many cell lines lack any sort of supporting clinical data, such as patient history, effects of impact of treatments performed, as well as just more details about how the cell line was derived. And then typically there's no normal sample from the same donor to make comparisons. And then finally, there's just a lack of in vivo relevancy. You know, cell lines are very homogeneous, so they lack, for example, multiple cell types, any sort of tissue organization, you know, a microenvironment, that's all actually found in tumors in vivo. So the HCMI's goal is to address some of the limitations of these existing in vitro models by creating new models that better mimic in vivo physiology and capture the genetic landscape that does not exist with the currently available models. This is at a high level what the members of the consortium look like, who's actually doing the work. Very briefly though, you know, the funding is primarily provided by the National Cancer Institute in the US and Cancer Research UK, as well as the Hub Foundation in Europe. There are many institutions generating models. I'm not gonna go into any detail. So, you know, the HCMI's goal is really to develop a large number of models, particularly from rare or otherwise underrepresented cancers. So this is pediatric cancers, glioblastomas, and then try to capture that diversity of genetic background that you see in a patient population. So it's not about having one model from a particular cancer type. It's about having 10, 20, 50 available to capture that genetic landscape. They also want to accompany the models with clinical and so patient data, as well as sequencing data, both from the primary cancer tissue, normal tissue, and the in vitro model. Additionally, you know, principles of the consortium are that the model should be a community resource. So they wanted them to be made as widely available as possible for use both in academic research and in industry applications. So this includes an awareness of relevant intellectual property issues related to the technologies that are being used for the model generation and culture. They wanted permissive informed consent. So that allows for broad use in a variety of applications such as drug screening or subsequent sequencing. And then finally, global distribution and having the protocols be open and available as a platform. So why does HCMI feel that this is possible now? Why wasn't this done before? And essentially, it comes down to the emergence and development of a variety of advanced culture technologies that are now being utilized by the HCMI. And the idea is they directly support that goal of generating a large number of models from a diverse assortment of cancers. So the techniques are very different, but their end result is broadly the same. So, all the techniques they're using essentially allow for the growth and expansion of cells and tissues that otherwise wouldn't grow or would be very difficult to grow using traditional approaches. So, these are not tissues that would grow in, DMEM plus 10% serum, something like that. Second, they theoretically require very little starting material. So this is necessary when you're generating models from something like a needle biopsy, circulating cells from the blood or urine, where there just isn't much material to start with. The resulting culture should be genetically stable over time. This is necessary for the large-scale production and distribution. They should also exhibit or maintain something like an in vivo phenotype, or something that's at least better than kind of a purely 2D monolayer culture using traditional cell culture techniques. And then finally, the techniques have a relatively high success rate of generating in vitro models. So the take rate is relatively high. This is critical when you're dealing with difficult to acquire primary tissue samples where you might not get a second chance to make that model. And again, what's special about these models is not just that they're new or that they utilize these novel culture technologies such as organoids, but it's really the level of annotation. So they're including this molecular characterization as well as the clinical data. So the consortium's goal is to have whole genome sequencing and whole exome sequencing of the individual models, the primary tumor, and normal tissue for comparison. And then thanks to these kind of special broad consents where the patient tissue was collected, anonymized, patient clinical data will also be available for the models. So, HCMI has described these as next generation cancer models because they utilize a variety of advanced culture methods and both 2D and 3D. So it includes organoids, neurospheres, conditionally reprogrammed cells, as well as highly specialized tissue and disease-specific media formulations. For this talk, I'm really just going to focus on the primary tissue-derived 3D organoid models for the sake of time. So for those not familiar, this technology came out of Hans Cleaver's lab at the Utrecht Institute in the Netherlands. They were studying, among other things, Wnt signaling, and his team discovered that this Wnt respondent pathway was really critical for maintaining and regulating adult tissue stem cells. Initially published with mouse tissue, and they were termed mini guts, they later adapted the technology to human tissues. It's fundamentally a three-dimensional culture technique where cells from primary tissues are embedded within an extracellular matrix, combined with specialized media formulations that have tissue or disease-specific niche factors, recombinant proteins, small molecules, some other things. This figure shows a little schematic of what this kind of workflow looks like, but at a high level, you take individual cells or fragments, which can be isolated from larger tissues. They're suspended in this extracellular matrix. You then deposited this suspension onto tissue culture plastic, for example. The ECM will polymerize and form a solid gel. You can then overlay the gel dome with liquid media containing whatever relevant growth factors are required. Over time, these individual cells and fragments will expand, self-organize into larger three-dimensional structures. Typically, they have a lumen, so they have a hollow interior. And so on the right here, we're looking at a small image of organoids in culture. And just to be clear, while they look like rings, these are actually, this is actually a cross section. They're more like kind of like spherical balloons. Here I want to show two very brief videos that kind of just better demonstrate what this actually looks like in the lab from a hands-on perspective. Here we have a technician depositing liquid ECM containing organoids onto standard tissue culture plastic, and then they form these small independent domes. On the left, they're just using a single channel pipette, and then on the right is a slightly scaled up version where they're using a multi-channel pipette to seed onto a 10 centimeter dish. The goal here is just to give you a better idea of what these individual kind of domes look like. While organoid culture is relatively easy and has many similarities to traditional cell culture, you can initiate a culture from frozen cells. They can be serially passaged and expanded, cryopreserved and recovered. Working with the ECM is somewhat different, and we've recognized that it can be a bit of a challenge for those unfamiliar with the technique to implement in their labs. To that end, we published a methods publication in Current Protocols in Cell Biology. It provides a step-by-step guide for thawing, expanding, and then cryopreserving HCMI organoids. As well as we also have a video protocol to make it even easier to get started with this in a laboratory. So this image shows what the organoid process actually looks like in vitro. So again, under the microscope, here we're seeing a looping 6-day time lapse from a single droplet of organoids starting from cryopreserved material. This is actually a PDAC model, so a pancreatic ductal adenocarcinoma. As you can see at the beginning, there's sort of a mixture of very small organoids or organoid fragments. They rapidly grow and expand. They exhibit this fairly typical cystic morphology with a very obvious lumen. And then at the end of this 6 days, a week, 2 weeks, it depends on the model, you can collect the culture, break the organoids back into fragments. You can reseed and expand. You could cryopreserve, or you can use them in downstream experiments. So, you know, one example of something you might want to do with organoids is immunocytochemistry. So this is an example of that. Depending on the tissue and the model, organoids can exhibit cellular polarization as well as organization and tissue and cell type relevant markers. Importantly, you know, this is a heterogeneous population of cells. So not every cell within an individual organoid is the same, nor are the organoids necessarily exactly the same within a culture. And this captures the heterogeneity that's inherent to, you know, a tumor in vivo. This is just showing some immunofluorescent staining performed on three different organoid models, one from the esophagus, one from the colon, and one from the lung, for a variety of kind of tissue-relevant markers. Commonly, we see Ki-67, so a proliferation marker. Ekinherin and beta-catenin are markers of epithelial cells, as well as the Wnt pathway, which is often aberrant in cancer. And then also some cell type specific markers like mucin, which reflects the presence of differentiated cells, goblet cells. Obviously, drug screening is a primary application for cancer organoids. And here we're looking at data from a really small study, just comparing the effect of three common chemotherapy drugs, topotecan, cisplatin, paclitaxel, on viability in three different in vitro lung models. So we have a classic non-small cell lung cancer model of lung adenocarcinoma, which is A549 cells, which is a continuous cancer cell line. We have a patient-derived organoid model, also from lung adenocarcinoma, as well as normal primary lung epithelial cells, so non-diseased. They were treated with 4 doses of each drug, assayed every 24 hours, and then viability was assessed using a very common ATP assay. I'm not going to go into this in really any detail, but I just want to kind of point out that on the right, we have some images of the organoid model specifically just at the last time point showing the highest dose of the drug. As you can see in the images, the lung cancer organoids were sensitive to the topotecan and cisplatin, as evidenced both by the ATP assay, but also visible by the morphology change in the organoids. They lose integrity and they fall apart, and that's what you're seeing on those figures on the right, the top two. But interestingly, you know, the organoids were seemingly not affected by paclitaxel, even though it was highly toxic to the A549 cells and the normal primary cells. It turns out this particular organoid lung cancer model has a KRAS mutation that has been shown to convey paclitaxel resistance in vitro. And critically, this mutation is much more common than the KRAS mutation that's present in the A549 cells, which are also known to be paclitaxel sensitive. So this is just an example of how these primary patient-derived organoid models can be potentially more representative of patient populations than existing cancer cell lines. I wanted to highlight one publication. So from last year, they looked at the methylation landscape of a set of the HCMI organoid models that ATCC is distributing, and then they compared them with normal tissue, primary tumors, as well as cancer cell lines, all from the same tissues. They used microarrays, and they analyzed by hierarchical clustering, and that's shown on the figures on the right. Might be a little hard to read, but suffice it to say that, you know, they found the methylation profiles of the cancer organoids were distinct from healthy tissue of the same type. And they also found that the cancer organoids cluster together with the primary tissue profiles, not with the primary tumor tissue profiles, not with the profiles from the cancer cell lines. So, you know, the conclusion here is that the HCMI cancer organoids maintain a more characteristic epigenetic signature of a tumor, and they do so to a greater extent than, you know, a similar cancer cell line would. Also, all this data they made available on the NCBI online if you're interested in it. I'm going to segue to just a couple slides on the portfolio of models that are actually currently available. The left figure shows a breakdown by tissue type. As you can see, most of the models currently are derived from primary tumors, but we also have a significant number of models derived from metastatic tumors, and then fewer recurrent and premalignant derived models. In fact, in some cases, we have paired models from the same donor. So we have models from the primary tumor, as well as one or more models from metastatic tumors that came from the same patient. On the right, we have a breakdown of models by the primary tissue site. In fact, we have 19 different primary tissue sites. The bulk of the models, again, currently are from brain, colon, pancreas, and esophagus. But we also have, you know, more uncommon tissues, stomach, lung, breast, small intestine, kidney models, et cetera. On the left here, we're looking at the breakdown by actually diagnosed disease to really show the diversity in the portfolio. In line with the prior slide, you know, the bulk of the models are from colorectal cancer, glioblastomas, pancreatic cancer, as well as esophageal cancer. But we also have rare and pediatric cancers, so rhabdomyosarcomas, Wilms tumor, Ewing sarcomas. The figure on the right is the portfolio by model type. So this is really bucketing them by technology. Just the takeaway here is that, you know, a significant majority of the models are in fact 3D organoids, and we expect this to actually increase further as we continue to add new models. Looking forward, the goal is to expand the portfolio to over 250 in the next year or so. We're going to be adding a lot more colon, esophageal, pancreas to better capture that genetic landscape. Again, the idea is not just to have a few, it's to really have a lot of each cancer type. We want to double the number of mammary carcinoma organoid models and then bolster the rare and pediatric cancers. And then finally, some new cancer types should also be coming out. Head and neck and ovarian models that we don't currently have should be released soon. I'm going to wrap up kind of the presentation just talking very quickly about a few resources if you're interested in learning more. ATCC website, of course, we have a page dedicated to the HCMI models. You can find them by tissue. They also have other model-specific information. There's an HCMI searchable catalog, which is run by the National Cancer Institute. It's designed to be a central source. It really links all the information about the models. It has advanced filtering, searching capabilities to help you find models that you're interested in, and then accessing that molecular and clinical data as well. And then finally, I didn't really have sufficient time to go into the molecular characterization of the data available, but it all lives at the Genomic Data Commons. This is a centralized repository of large cancer data sets. It hosts TCGA. If you're interested in the data, this is where you find aligned reads for whole genome sequencing, whole exome sequencing, also the transcriptome data. You don't need to even have the models. If you want to access this data, you can go to the website. It costs nothing. With that, I'm basically out of time, so I'm going to close. But just to summarize, over the next few years, the Human Cancer Model Initiative seeks to really generate and make available through ATCC maybe 1,000 novel patient-derived cancer models. It will include a variety of cancer and tissue types. In addition to just making the models available, there will be a wealth of associated clinical and sequencing data that will be provided at, again, no cost. You don't need to buy the model if you're just interested in the bioinformatics or clinical data. We currently have a portfolio of about 177. That's a little out of date, but we're releasing new models basically on a monthly basis. ATCC is really excited to be involved in this HCMI program and making these next generation cancer models widely available to the research community. So thank you very much for your time and your attention today.